If there is such a thing as a storybook campaign of the New Hampshire primary, it has to be the race run in 2000 by Senator John McCain of Arizona. While it had the feel of pure political magic, that victory was the result of months of hard work by an inexhaustible candidate. Already a decorated and well-known Vietnam War hero, Senator McCain endeared himself to thousands of Granite Staters with his humor, his candor, and more than 100 town hall meetings. His campaign first gained traction here among veterans. He stuck with them, and they stuck with him until the very end. Here's Kate Amara on the eve of primary 2000.
Who do you want to be the next president of these United States?
John McCain's final push to shore up support before Tuesday's vote. The latest tracking polls have George W. Bush closing the gap in a very tight race.
Everybody says that it's very close. I think it is very close. I think it's possible we could be up late on Tuesday night.
After his 114th and final town hall meeting in Peterborough, the Arizona senator switched gears to rallies, repeating his campaign's theme that the government must be reformed and rolling out his own brand of a big endorsement.
Frankly, we need a man with his experience to run this country.
He's one of my dearest friends and one of my heroes that saved my life in prison, so I'm always honored to be in his company.
The message that resonates with the veterans here also registered with at least one dedicated Republican.
When he has to make those decisions in the dark by himself that all presidents have to make, I think he'll be the best prepared.
The campaign strategists believe they can win on Tuesday, but win, lose, or draw, they say the real story is how this maverick made his way to one of the top spots in the New Hampshire primary.
I'm Kate Amara, WMUR News 9.
And we know now that race was not close at all. Senator McCain beat then-Governor George W. Bush by nearly 20 percentage points. We are joined now by the architect of that victory, McCain for President in New Hampshire, the architect and campaign manager, Mike Dennehy. Mike, thanks so much for your time.
Great to be here, Adam.
Did you guys have a sense that it was going to be that big of a blowout?
No, not at all. The polls had been, his leads had ranged anywhere from 5 to as much as, I think, 17 points. Only one poll showed him 17 points ahead. It was actually a Franklin Pierce University poll. And it was the closest one, ironically. So, just looking at that brings back some amazing memories. And, you know, it's just once in a lifetime campaign. You don't see a campaign like that ever.
Yeah. In 1999, all of the establishment money, the volunteers, the resources, the endorsements are all going the way of George W. Bush. Where did the campaign see an opportunity to start building?
Certainly starting with veterans. We had tried the traditional route of elected officials and party activists and typical Republican political organizations. It just didn't work. So we started with veterans and going to VFWs, which of course is what you see candidates do all the time now, and built from the veterans who were the post commanders or the auxiliary members, the lady auxiliary. And it was a very big operation that started with veterans and grew from there.
In most campaigns, you have ups and downs. In this one, it was a slow build until really nobody could sense how big it was until almost the last few weeks when it was too late for the Bush team to do anything, too late for the national media almost to catch up. It's suddenly a juggernaut.
No doubt about it, Adam. It truly, when I say once in a lifetime, to have a campaign, to have a plan that you execute without any bumps in the road, is just unheard of nowadays, and it may be unheard of forever because so much has changed with the 24-hour news cycle and social media and digital and so forth. But back then, it was just everything. It was a perfect storm that came together of candidates that dropped out, like Elizabeth Dole, Dan Quayle, Pat Buchanan. There were several candidates who dropped out, and John McCain stayed and grew in support. It was just unbelievable, truly.
And the candidate in this case opened himself up in a way that you don't often see many candidates do. How important was the media strategy here in New Hampshire to winning?
Well, you know, it's funny, Adam. You hit on something that isn't thought of much when you look back at a John McCain campaign. He's known for the town hall meeting and having so many that it created a buzz in community after community around the state by having so many town hall meetings and opening himself up to voters. But he did the same thing with the media. He actually started really the bus for a campaign. A campaign bus, it had been heard of before, but he started it early in about September, October time frame, and he started to have town hall meeting with reporters.
They sit around him like we see in this video.
Exactly right. And people have to know that it's exhausting for a candidate to be open to the media and answering questions nonstop. Then you get off the bus and you do it in front of voters. It's truly something that is phenomenal. And I don't know if it would be done again by a candidate. They could try, but not to the extent that John McCain did it, because it was 24/7.
Yeah, and we've seen others try to replicate this success, particularly on the town hall side of things. Do you think, and you can do the town halls, but there was another element here where Senator McCain brought in the aspect of his integrity and his war service and his imprisonment and his patriotism. It really, it wasn't just the town halls. He would also admit his mistakes. He would also say, I was wrong on this, things like that.
And he would, say that that this is my position. He may have been wrong. He would also say, this is my position. You may disagree with me, but I promise you, I will always tell you the truth. And that's what we needed so badly in the White House at that time. So it's now become customary for candidates to do town halls, which is wonderful for New Hampshire. It's wonderful for the process. But it was really just kind of taken to a level of extraordinaire with John McCain and the media strategy. Just back to that for a second. It opening yourself up to the media, especially the local media. National media is one thing, but we needed to create that buzz in New Hampshire. So to keep it going from town hall meetings, you open yourself up. We always had someone from the Concord Monitor, Union Leader, Nashua Telegraph, the Fosters. They were always on the bus and with us, and that gave them an incentive to write a story, because we were up against George W. Bush, who pushed the media away. And it was just a wonderful contrast.
And you look back at that one, and it's, at the time you're thinking, wow, this is great, but it really caught lightning in a bottle. It's not like you see a campaign like that just coming around every cycle.
No, you don't. To have everything line up the way it did. A lot of candidates want that to happen and try desperately, but it's difficult. And I think we'll see things like that in this campaign for president in 2016, because so many candidates are in the race and some will drop off and others will pick up. But to have that perfect storm happen against a juggernaut like George W. Bush, it would be similar to if someone were able to knock off Jeb Bush.
Yeah. And in a way, that campaign sort of validates all of the best things that we believe about the New Hampshire primary back in 2000.
Well, it gives all of the confirmation needed to a candidate wanting to run for president and believing they have a chance because of what happens here in New Hampshire.
All right. Mike Dennehy, well done in 2000, and thanks so much for your time.
Always good.
And thank you for joining us for this installment of Primary Vault.